I'm heading on up there here in a second. Jimmy, swap places with me if you don't mind, and make sure this is on me.
Okay. What'd you have to do?
It was one thing, and it wasn't set to pack report.
What wasn't set to pack report? Okay. Hello, everybody. My name is Adrian Crenshaw, and I'm filing up a couple of VMs that we're going to be using during this class. Just to make sure I have everything ready, and actually, turn the camera for just a second, would you? Okay. I need to unhook something.
Okay.
I just realized something I need to set up. Let me see. I need to start my Kali install. Well, by the way, did you get the Raspberry Pi on the network also?
No.
It's not on the network? Remember, the backbone also is, that didn't last long, is also that switch there, that managed switch is also. Okay. Let me get up my slides as well. Yeah, that may not stay very long. Hi, my name is Aiden Crenshaw, and my section is module 1, 2, and 3 is broken down by Jeremy here, and that's going to be covering essentially active reconnaissance, scanning, and introduction to TCP IP for pen testers, basics of using Nmap, using Nmap for host discovery, and basics of using Nmap, understanding Nmap output. This is me. I've pretty much been introduced already by Jeremy. Got interest in InfoSec education. Don't know anything. I may screw some things up, especially when I start talking about what happens when you communicate a report in a given state. And I'm a senior information security consultant at TrustedSec, send us work, and also a co-founder of DerbyCon. Okay, by the way, everything I state here is my opinion. It doesn't reflect the humor or opinions of any other company, unless of course they agree with me. So, the what and why is of port scanning. Since ports are fairly standard, you can tell if port 80 TCP is open on a box, you have a good idea that it's running a web server. Not 100%, you could run email on that port as well, but more likely it is HTTP. By the way, with someone on occasion, make sure to look at the screen, and it's still going. Also, I'm a paranoid individual when it comes to my video recordings. So everything's good there. All right, so if port 80 is open, you have a good idea that it's running web services. And knowing what things are open on a box or in a network gives you an idea of attack surface, what things you could possibly go after. And by sending packets to these numbered ports, you can figure out, is that service on here or not? Will these attacks work? And also, depending on what ports are open, you have a good idea what OS is running on that particular machine, though that's a little bit more questionable. And knowing what services are running lets you know something about the potential attack service, as I stated before. Also, there's different oddities in how people implement their TCP IP stack that allow you to probe them and figure out what OS they are. So, a little intro to Nmap. This is one of the most popular port scanners. There's a few others out there, but pretty much everybody seems to default back to using Nmap. It was started by Gordon Lyon, Fyodor, back in 1997. It originally published in Frack magazine, so at one time you could actually publish the code in a magazine.
The good old days.
It started as a fairly simple port scanner, and it was meant partly for stealth. One of the things it did was instead of doing a freeway handshake completely, they would just do the send scan part, and at the time, people wanted to detect the connection because they were looking for a full connection. Since that's changed, but it started adding more and more features, and now it's become, well, it's a ton of features, let's put it that way. It's also multi-platform. You have Linux, Windows, BSD, OS X. It's been ported to just about anything. The way I actually met Fyodor was way back when I got these, this is actually how I got into InfoSec in a large part. I got this thing called a Sharp Zorz. It was a tiny little Linux box. It came out in like 2004 or so. It was 2003 probably. And at the time, a little handheld Linux device was pretty rare. So I was figuring out how to put all these security tools on it, and one of them was Nmap. And Fyodor saw that I posted an article on it, and it showed me holding my hand in like the registration lab and the little was always in my hand. He was like, can I use that photo in my book? I'm like, cool. So that's how I met him. And so a lot of my background in security actually falls back and is inspired by Nmap. It's open source and is available at nmap.org. Hopefully everybody already has that. And also, if you want to do this class with just Nmap or whatever your host OS is, that's fine. Hopefully though, most of you have installed Kali. How many people have installed Kali, at least in a VM? Good. Okay, a little bit of the basics of TCP and UDP. And by the way, co-presenters, feel free to speak in anytime. To use an analogy, if IPs are apartment complexes, you know, the address of a particular building, then ports would be like the particular part number. You use these ports to say what application on this machine is going to listen and service this particular network traffic. You have both UDP and TCP that for incoming and outgoing ports, and we're going to talk a little bit about them, but depending on what's open, you have a good idea of what's running in the box. Here's some common ports. You know, HTTP is going to port 80 TCP, SMTP is normally port 25 TCP, SMB is a collection of ports, 139 and 445. Quite often you scan a box and you see those particular ports open, you have a good idea it's probably a Windows box. There'd also be a Linux box running Samba, I suppose, depending on how it's configured. But, you know, that and a few of the other RPC ports that they normally use will give you a good idea it's a Windows box. But there's better ways of telling as well. Also, DNS is on port 53, TCP and UDP. Maybe some hosts will only listen on UDP. TCP is used for things like zone transfers when they're trying to synchronize lists with each other. All right, here's the host header. Now that you have time to memorize all that, here's the TCP header. But essentially, you can see, I referred to the TCP IP stack before. Essentially, you have protocols on top of protocols on top of protocols. For instance, IP might be on top of Ethernet or something else, but usually we're talking about IP on top of Ethernet. Even wireless is, well, looks like Ethernet from a certain standpoint. I'll try and think of what the acronym is. A priest watches nuns doing push-ups for the OSI model.
That's right.
Yeah, it's something like that. There's some other ones I have as well that are much more perverted. I learned electronics way back in the bad days. Anyway, one protocol lies on top of another. So you have the physical layer, you're going to have basically the wire and the cabling or the wireless signals. You know, you're going to have your data link layer, so you're going to have things like Ethernet. You're going to have your networking layer, which I believe is where we're going to put on IP. You have your transport. Am I going right so far? Mm-hmm. Transport, which we're going to have TCP. And by the way, some of these get a little fishy where they fall into your session presentation application. Mm-hmm. Did I get that all right?
Yeah.
Okay. I think I got most of it right. So at the very lower levels, though, you know, above Ethernet, you're going to have IP, either IP4, IP6, something else, and a few other protocols out there. On top of IP, right, it's TCP. And you can see this is encapsulation. So you have IP on the outside, and inside that there's another header for TCP. So now that you have those two memorized, actually we're going to break them down a little bit further. There's all sorts of options in TCP IP version 4. It actually got simplified in version 6, believe it or not. Yeah, the addresses look like hell, but the protocol itself, in many ways, has actually been simplified. There's a lot of options they threw in here to say, you know what, we may use this at some point in time. Like there's an unused bit that was, one of the options, TCP options, that was unused, and someone recommended we use it for the evil bit. So that if you send evil traffic, turn this bit on so we know to filter you. It was an RFC that Alan put out on April 1st many years ago. What I want to do, if anybody knows how to modify their TCP IP stack to send everything as evil bit, I really want to do that and see what happens on the network. There should be a way for me to modify things to do that, but good stuff.
Maybe with the escapee, perhaps?
Maybe with escapee, but I want all my traffic. I want to make essentially a router that makes everything evil. Okay, below IP, though, you're normally going to have Ethernet, which you're going to encounter, and you have MAC addresses, Media Access Control. This is usually 12 digits in hexadecimal, doesn't have to be. So pretty much anything that has Ethernet is going to have this burnt in and have a 12-digit hexadecimal number it's going to be associated with. If I was to go out to the command prompt on here and, let's see if we can do this. If you see how I've done an ifconfig here a little bit ago, that's my MAC address. By the way, from the first part of this MAC address, you can tell who the vendor is, which we'll get to here in a bit. But everybody's got a MAC address. There's one that should be unique, should be, not always, sometimes manufacturers screw up, burnt into your network card. And if someone asks an exam, say it's non-changeable, it's static, but it can be changed. I have tools out there like Mad Max for changing it, and or just simply ifconfig. But usually it's 48 bits, 6 bytes long. See that as 12 hexadecimal digits. Like here's my favorite. By the way, can we turn down the lights? I just noticed how hard that is to read. You won't be able to see my beautiful face on camera, but that's all right. Is that a little easy on anybody?
Yeah,
all right. Dead Beef Cafe. That is my favorite MAC address, and it's the easiest way I know of to remember how many digits are in a MAC address. Also, I'm a big meat eater. Now, this other one, you know, yeah, I guess you dead, whatever you like. The first six hexadecimal digits of that is the OUI, Organizational Unique Identifier. And the rest in blue is going to be unique. Each organization gets assigned a list. If you ever want to know who owns what MAC addresses, you can actually go up to this particular location and find out. Also, there's something called EUI 64 MAC addresses. I don't know where these things are used. I haven't really encountered one, but there are actually MAC addresses that are much larger. The way IPv4 works, if you've been wondering about this, is you have a 32-bit address. So let's take 192.168.1.1. If you're all attached to Nmap class, that should be that particular IP address as the gateway. You can represent this in all sorts of ways. Used to be back in the day, people would trick people into clicking on the wrong links, because instead of putting the IP address for a box, they would actually represent it as decimal, hexadecimal, and I don't think the binary worked in web browsers, but I believe these two did, and so you could really confuse the living hell out of somebody with that. Like you might do something like, Apple, I think the trick I did way back in the day was apple.com at some weird address, and I pointed them to say Apple was switching to the AMD processors for the machines. This was back in the late 90s, and I thought that was humorous. Then, strangely enough, they switched to an Intel-based architecture a few years later. But you can represent an IP address in more than one way. There's approximately 4-something billion addresses possible. If you want to figure it out, do the math in your head. 2 to the 32nd power. That's how many IP addresses you have available, more or less. I think you have to subtract maybe 2 from that. There's certain ones that have been set aside, of course, which caused part of our IP space allocation problems. These began running out, which is one of the reasons for IP version 6 and the use of NAT. By the way, if you ever wonder, and I'm going to use universities as test subjects for some things in here, because universities are great test subjects as far as weird things are hanging off their network and are out there publicly addressable. I remember someone asked at a conference recently, why do so many universities just put their stuff out there on the network, you know, for anybody to access? Well, because back in the day, they got in on that IP land grab early, because originally the internet was sort of for universities and military projects and so forth, so they got on that early, they got huge blocks of IP ranges, so they don't have to necessarily net. But the advantage of that for us is they make great test subjects. All right. So here's the IP version 4 headers. So remember, this is going to be outside, this is going to be encapsulating what TCP is on the inside. And we have tons of things. We will count from 0, by the way, whenever someone says like bit 0, this, that. They start from 0, not, the first bit is not 1. And every you have seen this on our test, by the way, the reason I keep referring back to a test, some of these slides, I copied these slides when I saw what Jeremy had planned. I was like, oh crap, I need to get a bunch of stuff. And I had already made a bunch of slides that I've never finished producing for a CISSP, I think I called it a not quite safe for work CISSP guide. So if you see anything inappropriate here, it's because I copied from those slide deck. But I was working through making all of these. So in case you may see a reference to the test. But remember, 0 is where things actually start off. But you have a few different things there. Version is obvious. This is going to be set to 4 in binary. Internet header length tells you how big the internet header is going to be, 4 to 7. Type of service or the priority of the packet. You got the total length of what the packet's going to be, so everything in it, including data, which includes the TCP header. Because for the TCP header, to IP, the TCP header is data. Identification, this is used for fragmentation. Some networks can't use a certain packet size, so they have to break things up, and identification allows you to put those back together later on when they reach the final host. Then there's all sorts of flags that are used for fragmentation, like, well, I believe the do not fragment flag is in that one, correct? Well, I might get to it in a bit. Fragment offset, so you can, you know, help put things back together. Time to live. By the way, this was an incredibly bad name. Originally, time to live, the plan was this would be the number of seconds the packet's allowed to live on the network before a router goes, screw it, I give up, we can't deliver this. Because you don't want packets circling around the internet forever. Well, they forgot something when they were calculating this. They were like, you know what, we have no way of tracking when the packet actually got on the network. So how do we know how many seconds it's really been out there? Now, some devices literally follow the RFC and after a second drop it and they time things. But generally, it's actually been used as a hop count. So in TCP IP version 6, they actually renamed the field and call it hop count. But essentially, it keeps decrementing, and once it gets down to zero, a router will go, okay, I'm done. So for each hop, it gets decremented by one. But this is no way you can tell OSs apart, because different OSs use a different default hop count. So if you're like sniffing the network, sometimes you can tell what OS is by that. Also, you have the protocol in this. This is going to be like ICMP, TCP, and UDP a lot of times. So there is a few others, like what is it? SCTP? And we're not going to talk a whole lot about that one, but this tells you what protocol is actually going to be embedded inside. Header checksum to see if anything screwed up the packet along the way. Source address, destination address, a ton of options. This may be where the do not flag and fragment part is. I'm not sure.
I think it's in flags.
You think it is in flags? Okay, I wasn't sure if it was in this or options. I think this is where also in options, some of the bits was unused, and I think that's where they set the evil bit. I should have put that in the slides. If you'd like more information on this, yeah, sources out here for all sorts of extra options you can have inside. Let's see, padding, just make it out to a 32-bit boundary, and that is the core of the IP packet. Now, I've mentioned a little bit about fragmenting before. When something goes across the network, sometimes not everything is transmitting the same size. Often you're limited to like 1,500 bytes. And sometimes the packet's got to be broken up to fit and all that. So they use that IP ID and the offset mentioned to put the packets back together when they get to the destination. And you also have the maximum transit unit on path that can be found by using the do not fragment flag. And you can kind of figure out what devices are along the network by how it fragments things. We're not going to handle that manually, though I think the Nmap may do some of that as well. Nmap just has a ton of features. A little bit about IP version 6. 128-bit addresses, so a lot more. What is it they say? More than the atoms of the universe, or some many number? So the number of that is, I'm going to use the American English version, apparently 346 trillion. Oh, sorry, that's the Brits that do that, that's the English that do that. We call it a 340 unidecimal. It's not unidecimal? Anyway, it's not really a thing you have to remember. And in some ways, IP version 6, it has a simpler header. We basically have version, traffic class, label flow, payload length, next header, and hop limit, and source and destination address. And the next header, I believe, that is where you store all sorts of different options if they're needed. By the way, double check on everything I say here, because I could be getting things wrong. I don't regularly have to deal with IP version 6. How many people actually deal with IP version 6 a whole lot right now? And no one in the room raises their hand. That's a little disturbing. One of the things you do want to check into IP version 6, though, is you're probably running it even if you don't think you are. Because by default, since Windows Vista, it's on by default. So you're more likely running it.
And oftentimes people implement
Speak it loud.
So oftentimes people implement firewalls and leave any on IPv6.
Yes, which would be a bad thing depending on how things are routed. And right now, by the way, I'm connecting an Android device to the backbone of wireless router we'll be using for scanning because I just want more things on there. There we go. Oh, actually, you know what? I just had that's a router. I'm just gonna walk over here and check it and make sure this is set the way I think it should be set up. That's good. All right, hopefully I got enough hosts up. I tried to run a whole bunch of different VMs at one time on a box over here, so we'll see how it's working. My version is set to 6. That's one key difference. So that very first part of the packet, that's how you can tell IP4 from IP6 when it starts crossing the network. Traffic class and flow control are used for quality of service. Yeah, payload length is the size of the payload, not including the IP header itself. The next header points to the header of the encapsulated protocol, hop limits instead of the old time to live because it's a more accurate name, and source and destination. IP version 6, we'll talk a little bit about ARP in a second. IP version 6, oh, I believe there is a version of ARP of a sort for it, but it doesn't have to use ARP because the IP is based on the MAC address itself.
Yes, I think the MAC's even included in the
IP address, but there's ways of, I can't remember what Microsoft's change to that is to make it still based, but where you don't have the MAC address totally in there. But yeah, IP version 6 address is based on the MAC address and IP version 6 routing advertisements. So it sees routing advertisements, goes, okay, this is my network, I'm going to paste this in here, and that becomes part of my IP address. But as FFFE is added to the MAC if it's a 48-bit, it can be used as a EUI 64 MAC address that already has 64 bits. It uses this that little colon for notation. So you'll see an IP address something like this as IP version 6. And you can substitute a bunch of zeros, but only once to truncate things. So you have something that looks a little bit like this.
Do you have a Wireshark running?
A Wireshark running?
Maybe you can.
Not at the moment.
Oh.
The above is a local link address, by the way. You can tell because it starts with FE80, and it can be used to talk to other IP version 6 devices on the same subnet, essentially, or the same local area network. And universal or local UL is set to 1 if it's put in the MAC address, it's overridden. So you can supposedly tell whether or not it's been someone's bothered to change the MAC address on that machine. Though I imagine there's ways around that. I haven't really tested it. IP version 6 is not something I have to mess with on a day-to-day basis. I'm sure people will comment on the YouTube comment section and say, no, you got this wrong. But sometimes you'll hear people refer to class A's, class B's, class C's, class D's, and class E's. Class A's are freaking huge. You're talking about over 60 million IP addresses. Class B's over 65,000. C's 256. And it's basically broken down by what ranges. By the way, if you see an IP address in a certain range, you can actually tell what class it was originally assigned because they assigned them by these particular regions. Also, certain parts of the IP space are set aside for like multicast, and other ones are just plain reserved. We may not have, early on they set aside certain IP address ranges for certain purposes, and because of that, it's probably one of the reasons we ran out of IP space as early as we did, because that's not necessarily perfectly used. Oh, by the way, have you ever noticed our IP addresses that you normally assign for like non-routables, or I should say private IP addresses, or you know 10 something something something, 192.168. something something, and notice one's an A and one's a B, and the other one I believe is 172, and then there's a certain range. It's somewhere in between. 172.16 and
172.32.
So, but those first two ones is A and B, if you notice. All right, side notation. We'll talk a little bit about side notation because when we get to Nmap, we're actually going to be addressing things this way. A lot of times when you write in your subnet mask, you're probably going to write it out in decimal notation. See, it's 255, 255, 255, and probably most of your local home networks are using that subnet mask. That can also be represented as slash 24 because it's 24 ones. That's the idea. Same thing with 16, that'd be 255, 255, 00, and of course 255, 000. And the reason this comes in useful is let's say you want to scan an entire network. Like let's you say you want to scan 192.168.1.anything. Well, what you can put in is 192.168.1.1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 8, whatever number at the last, and put a slash 24 on it. And that tells us that everything that starts with this IP address, everything that starts with this network part of the address. So we're using that for addressing later on. You can also use other subnet masks. That's just some common ones. The way a subnet mask works, let's talk about Dickens Corp. They make apple cider. And it uses IP address range 10 star 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 star. So let's say they use 255.255.240 as the subnet mask. That's a slash 20. Essentially, they would have this in binary, these ones and these zeros. And the way something mask is used is to tell whether or not you need to forward something to the gateway, to tell whether or not something's on your local area network. What it does is it takes the IP address that you're trying to look at, it ANDs it with that subnet mask, and if you AND your local IP address with that same subnet mask and they come up to be the same value, you know you're on the same network. Does that make sense? Because this first part of your IP address and someone else on your same network will be the same. And that's how a subnet mask is used, basically just to tell whether or not you need to forward something to the gateway.
Does your computer have, is it connected?
Yes.
Or you can do like an IP config? And
I do IF config.
Or, yeah, okay. Oh, yeah, Mac, all right.
Go ahead.
So, let's see.
What are you going to say?
Oh, I was just going to say you could show what your subnet mask is, which network you're connected to. So it looks like it's
scroll up a little bit. You can't see your actual.
I think it's above. Yeah, it's right off the top of the screen here. Oh, maybe it's actually up quite a bit better.
Yeah, I got a lot of interfaces because of virtualization and so forth.
Right there it is. That 192.168.1.101.
So it looks like you're on the 192.168.1 network.
Yes.
Because you got all F's until those last two zeros.
And that's my broadcast address, which is all ones in that in the host part of the IP address. Okay, a little bit about how ARC works. We're talking about IPv4 here still. I switched back and forth just mentioning a few things in 6, which I'm probably getting wrong. But here's a little bit about how ARC works. It's Address Resolution Protocol. It's considered to be layer 2, so data link layer. Address, it's for finding things on layer 3, IP address networking layer. And the way ARC works is essentially there's a message sent in and a box wants to know someone else in the local area network and says, hey, who has this particular IP address? And they send out a broadcast on Ethernet for this. And one machine should hopefully respond and say, yeah, that MAC address is mine. That IP address is mine. Here's my MAC address. And now we can communicate at the Ethernet level. And that's how Ethernet and IP address IP, TCP/IP communication between each other. Then communication can happen over Ethernet at that point. There's also address resolution protocol in reverse, and it's the opposite essentially. And it's sometimes used for diskless workstations. And let's see, you can also set up static ARP entries. Like, who has ever heard of ARP poisoning? Most of you have, so I don't have to describe it too deeply. But essentially, ARP poisoning is lying on the network. When someone says, hey, whose IP address is this? You say, hey, it's mine, even if it's not really necessarily yours. Or you're sending messages ahead of time saying, hey, you know that IP address? Yeah, that belongs to me. Here's my MAC address. Come to me. You can set up static ARP entries to keep that from happening, but it's a massive pain in the butt to manage. Though I do have a tool out on my website called ARP Freeze that you can actually statically set your the IP address to MAC address mappings. But basically, you have to ARP to be able to figure out if something's on your network. And that comes important a little bit later, because one of the ways Nmap will detect whether or not a host is up is it will ARP first. Okay. Transmission Control Protocol is the next thing we're going to talk a little bit about. It's considered a reliable protocol, unlike a UDP. With TCP, what happens is it actually establishes a session and keeps track of what has been sent both ways, and so it knows where the session is, it keeps things reliable, and if communication drops, it knows about it, because there's a certain order to it. Everything starts off with what's known as a three-way handshake, so it's when you send, acknowledge, acknowledge. And that's a three-way handshake to start up, to set up that session so you can communicate between two hosts. So here's a TCP header. We basically have source port and destination port, which are fairly obvious. That's like I was mentioning before, the apartment numbers in a complex. The sequence number and acknowledgement number, this is so we can keep the connection in sync and allow for knowing what packets got through. Because sometimes our network packets might also get back in the wrong order. And you got to reassemble it, that on the opposite end. And you also can figure out maybe if something has totally dropped. It's like, wait, I never did get this other packet I should have. What's going on? Data offset, the size of the TCP header in 32-bit words, at least 5, at max 15, and so forth. Then we can get into some of the reserve stuff. This is not used currently, but maybe later. They don't really have that. There was a few that were used in 2001 and 2003. They set up a couple flags for congestion. Was it misaligned or something?
It's fine. You're good. You're good.
Okay. Because it's different on that particular screen. Okay.
You're good.
Okay. They synthesized more things in 2001 and 2003. That's like congestion window reduced, explicit congestion notification echo, not sung, and so forth. Here's some other more common flags you're going to see, and these ones are the ones we're really going to talk about a lot with Nmap. Urge, this is set to say whether or not something is important and to go look for the urgent field. ACK says that acknowledgement field is important. Look at it. Should be set to all packets after the initial send. Push asks to be pushed the buffer data to the application. Reset the connection just basically says something's wrong, let's reset this. Something's not happening right. SYN is for synchronization to start up a session. And FIN is when all you're done, you want to tear down the connection. There's also window size for how much data you can send. And by the way, this is another one of those things that Nmap triggers on. Based on window size, you can kind of tell what OS something is, because they have different default window sizes. Checksum, see if anything's been screwed up in the packet. Urgent pointer. Options, and also padding more, and whatever the data it happens to be. This is the internet, that was most of the data. Doing a SYN acknowledge handshake, there's two parties that can make up their own sequence numbers to exchange. As the data is passed, each increments the other sequence number and passes it back to acknowledge the packet was received. So these just keep increasing, and they can keep track of, okay, is something out of alignment? Is it all getting here? What's happening? ACK used throughout and FIN used at the end to tear down the connections, and sometimes a reset. Okay, then there's also user datagram protocol. This is considered unreliable. Basically, you fire off a packet, hopefully it gets there, may not get there, all depends. And this is meant for when speed and low overhead is more important than reliability. So things where you don't mind losing some data. For instance, voice communications. If I'm calling you, If it's not reliable and a few things drop, like all the words don't quite make it, or if like, you know, it's like weird sound, like static, that's okay. You can probably mostly understand me. However, it'd be catastrophic if all the data got to you reliably, but 10 seconds from now. That would be a really hard conversation to have. So that, like streaming video and other items, might use UDP because getting there on time is more important than just losing a few bits. So it's lossly, and a lot of times it's used for things like NTP, VoIP, as I was saying, like voice example, DNS, where you want something quick, so you can say, hey, whose IP, oh, sorry, what IP goes with this name, and streaming videos, common examples of things used for UDP. This one has a much simpler header, a lot less overhead. You just have source port, destination port, the length, and the checksum, and, you know, whatever data you have in it. In the case of VoIP, you know, that's what you have. Anyway, I told you originally I put together these slides for a class called the Not Quite Safe for Work CISSP Guide. I didn't really change it much. Right. Ports, by the way, both TCP and UDP are going to be 16 bits. So you have ports from 0 to 65,535. So, by the way, 0 technically, my understanding, is not supposed to be used, but also can be. And what exactly is the rules on using 0? Do you know, Jeremy? I know it's possible, but it's not supposed to.
I've honestly, in any corporate environment, I've never seen it.
Never seen it. Does anybody know why 0 is not supposed to be used? Because I don't actually know the answer to that myself. I'm curious. But normally, 0 is not supposed to be used. The low 1023 are supposed to be only opened by root on like a Unix box. And those are reserved. Then anything above that is sometimes referred to as an ephemeral port. So 1024 and above. And most apps will use that one of those as a source. And anybody in theory can open up one of those. You don't have to be a super user to do it. A bunch of common ports. HTTP is 80 usually. HTTPS is normally 443. SMTP 25. SSH 22. 10UP 23. DNS 53. Both UDP and TCP. Okay. Yes?
I was just thinking about the whole zero thing. When you talk about the zero, you've got the opposite of that, which is the 254, which is usually a broadcast address, right? So the zero, I think, is supposed to designate what the network address is.
But in this case, we're talking about ports.
No, so like 192.168.1.0, that's supposed to designate that network, right? Yeah. And that's how it's supposed to be used, and so it can't be used because it's designating the network. Just like 254 is a broadcast address, it's not used by any specific IP address, or by any specific machine.
And that can make sense for IP addresses, but this is the port section. Port zero, not...
Oh, my bad.
So I'm not sure why port zero is... Am I saying it's not really supposed to be used? I'm not sure what the reason is.
Yeah. That's my bad.
I'm not quite sure the reason why. To tell you the truth, I'm not a huge networking guy. I just read a whole bunch of stuff.
One of the answers on the internet is that it's a programming technique that it's used, so it's reserved for that.
Reserved for a programming technique.
Yes. Port zero is a programming technique for specifying system allocated ports.
System allocated ports. It's supposed to be a programming technique for using system allocated ports.
Yeah.
So that's the answer for everybody that's watching at home. I don't know. That's an interesting bit of TCP IP trivia.
Well, it's on the internet. It must be true.
Exactly. All right. ICMP. ICMP is Internet Control Message Protocol, and it helps out with other protocols. It's considered to be layer 3, even though it rides on top of IP. All right. There's also the TCP IP model. Which closely matches TCP IP, but when they're trying to combine it in and say, let's make this fit the OSI model. The OSI model is only really useful for describing things. It's not necessarily useful for much else. But it's considered layer 3, if anybody has to do a test, apparently. And ICMP is used for troubleshooting, figure out what's going on. Unfortunately, it's not nearly as useful as it used to be because everybody blocks so much stuff. I personally wish everybody would allow a lot more stuff and just harden their system so I can do a trace route and know if a box is up and where things are falling apart. And it uses codes instead of ports, by the way. Here's a bunch of common codes. Echo, echo reply. We'll be using that a lot in pings. Type 3 is a destination unreachable. Just a bunch of ones. Network unreachable, host unreachable. I'm not going to go through all of these for time reasons. But there's all these different codes, and the only reason you probably have to know them most of the time is on a test or something, because if you're using a sniffer to figure out what's going on, it'll probably tell you right there, oh yeah, this is this particular ICMP message. Ping is stands for, I believe it's a packet internet grepper. Isn't that, what is it? Oh. Packet internet groper? Yeah, I think that's what it is. And it's named after sound sonar. Now I have it right in my slide what it is. It's a backronym for packet internet groper. So I got that one right. Backronyms, by the way, is when people come up with a cool name and then they decide later on how to make it match. Kind of like I did with the programmable head USB keyboard dongle. Of course, I came up with the name in my head first before I came up with the acronym. It's used to see if a host is up or not. So basically you say, ping, is it out there? Oh, yeah, it is. And it's based on the whole idea of like submarinas and listening for other subs or boats in the area. It's like, ping, you're out there. So it's not so reliable now that a lot of organizations block ICMP at the firewalls, which is kind of sad because I like to know when something's up. But sometimes security through obscurity, I guess, can help some. But as a troubleshooter, it's problematic. Traceroute is a protocol essentially for figuring out what is along your path on the internet to a particular host. Like, you want to know if, is my ISP down? Is someone else's ISP down? What's going on? In theory, if people aren't blocking certain messages, you can traceroute to something and find out. And the way traceroute works is they'll send out a packet with a hop count of 1. First router gets it, decrements, and goes, huh, this is legal now, I'll just drop the packet. And it returns an ICMP message that says time exceeded. And based on who sends you back that time exceeded message, you go, oh, this must be that hop where it stopped last. Then you set it to time delay to 2, you get the next hop, because the next person decrements it to 0 after the first one, and you figure out who they are based on the time exceeded message, and so on and so forth. And by doing this and watching each one of those time exceeded messages as you increment through each one of the time delays, you can figure out the path across the network. Point thing to remember though is there's a little bit of difference between Windows and Unix and how this works. Windows uses ICMP packets for this. They're like, oh, I don't know if it's echo or not, but let's say basically send out an ICMP packet with a time delay of 1 to begin with, 2 next. But Unix uses UDP packets. This kind of comes important when you're troubleshooting, because sometimes people will block ICMP, but not UDP. So the UDP one might work, or vice versa. There's also TCP versions of it you can download off the internet. When you know that they are blocking pings, but they are allowing port 80 open, it's our web server, sometimes you can use a trace about port 80 and be able to figure things out. Those people along the way that might drop the messages anyway. Yes?
In Linux, the trace route, the uh-huh. current version, it'll let you pick the protocol and the port.
Oh, the newest version will let you choose both? In the past, I had to download individual tools for that, but it'll let you choose protocol.
Yeah, they kind of combined it all into this one tool now.
That sounds awesome.
I don't know which version, but it's been out for a little while, I mean, at least a couple of years, where they sort of made it to where you have the --, TCP switch and UDP and ICMP switches, and then there's a --.
Also for port? That's nice.
Port, so you can combine it all together.
Yeah, so if you don't get a response on one, you can say TCP 80 and try to see if you get a message through.
Yeah, that's probably the best. That one, maybe 21.
So here's that example of trace route. Time to live of 1, decrements to 0, sends back the time to live exceeded message. To 2, time exceeded, and I kind of hit the button too quick. And, damn it. All my pretty animations. There we go. 3, send back the message. And finally, get a packet there. And you should get a message back, but you may get a message saying either that port's open, port's closed, get something back. We'll talk about what messages you get back based on port being open and closed in a bit. But that's trace route in a nutshell. Other common TCP protocols. Yeah, we're not going to go through all of these. There's a ton of ones. Unless you really want me to cover all of these. But a ton more different ports that they're on, so on and so forth. Now we'll actually get to the port scanning part. Have you had fun with TCP IP so far? So as far as I was supposed to should cover, is that what you wanted to cover, or is anything else I should really throw in there? Jimmy had it laid out for his classes.
No, that's good.
And I followed some of it, and other stuff I kind of winged it.
No, that's cool.
Here's my smiling computers. We're going to talk about two types of scans. We're going to talk about a connect scan and a send scan. A connect scan, remember how I mentioned that freeway handshake, send, send, acknowledge, acknowledge? That's how you're supposed to set up a connection. So let's give an example of that. The host initiating the connection will send out a send. Once that's received, the host you're trying to talk to will send back a send acknowledge. The host you're talking to may be the server, may not be a server, depending on how you want to look at it. But it's the one that's receiving the connection. And then once that happens, the original person who's establishing the connection will send an acknowledge, and now they have the sequence numbers, they know what they're talking about, they can start sending stuff back and forth through that socket, through that port. This thing was, one of the reasons that send scans were starting to be used is they were sometimes referred to as the stealth scans, because a full connection might be logged, but back in the day, a send scan, since it didn't establish a full connection, it was seen as a failed connection, it wouldn't necessarily be logged. Basically, the way it works, oh, by the way, this is a port scan in Nmap, so after it does the final ACK, it goes ahead and does a reset ACK after that. The reason for that is you don't want to leave a bunch of open or half-open connections on the remote box. Have you heard of SYN flooding? That's essentially what, if you didn't do that reset ACK at the end, you basically would be SYN flooding. You'd basically say, hey, establish a connection. And it has to use a little bit of memory for each one of those connections. So, used to be a way to take boxes off. So used to be a great way of DOSing systems. Now, a send scan is a little different. The first part starts up the same. You send a send. If the port is open, by the way, and all these, both of these are port open, you get back a send acknowledge. And then the Nmap box would send back a reset to go ahead and tear down the connection, because once again, you don't want to do a send flood where you're going to screw up the box. Now, let's say TCP/IP, you have a closed port. Well, you're going to send the initial send, of course. Just like before, always the first step. On a closed port, though, you should hopefully get back a reset ACK. And that will tell you, oh, that port is closed. So now I know when that port's open or closed. In a case in a closed port for doing a SYN scan, exact same thing. Reset ACK, because it's the same thing. You know it's closed, you don't have to establish anything else. Now, there are different types of scans, and this is where we get back into fingerprinting a little bit. Not all of them respond to the same. There's certain things in the RFCs, requests for comments, that are ambiguous about how you're supposed to implement things. So, with an ACK scan, you scan an open port or a closed port, you should get back a reset. But with an XMAS scan, you basically have all the flags turned on, well, except for the normal ones. You just have urge, push, and finish all turned on. And normally this should not happen. So you want to see how a box responds to it. Linux responds with no responses whatsoever. However, Windows responds with reset ACK. So that's a quick way of telling the difference between those two. And other platforms behave in different ways. I have this tool called Obfuscate at that beautiful, easy to remember URL that allows you to fake out various things in the TCP IP stack on Windows. And if I have time during Jeremy's talk, I'm actually going to go over there and configure a VM, hopefully use it, and make a Windows box look like something it's not. There's also UDP. Now, in UDP, a port's closed. In theory, you should get back an ICMP port unreachable error. And that way, you definitely know it's closed. However, again, a lot of people block all sorts of ICMP messages as they go through the borders, so it may not get back to you. Filtered or unreachable error is going to be those various codes. You can actually have a firewall via ICMP say, no, nah, we've purposely restricted that. You can't have it. That's a very polite firewall. open filtered should be no response. Not all UDP, unlike TCP, where you definitely have to get a response back because you're establishing a session. With UDP, you don't necessarily have a session. You could be something that's one-way traffic. You just want to send it out there, and there's not necessarily going to be any response. So that's why when Nmap labels an open filter, it may be open, or you may just be blocked from getting anything back. You don't really know. If you actually get something back, any response, it's open. And version detection, by the way, can also sometimes help you establish whether or not something is truly open or not, because it will send certain packets to it that require a response. For instance, if you just send a blank UDP packet to a DNS server, I'm not sure you'd get anything back. I'm not sure if it would error that out or would say something's wrong, but if you send it with a proper valid request for, hey, what IP address goes with this name, you would get back a response, sure. So sometimes version scanning might actually help you figure out whether that port's truly open. But let's go with some really simple Nmap scanning demos. So first we're going to scan just a single IP address. And if anybody wants to do this as well, hopefully our network can take it. I have a base install Kali, so it should be just like y'all's. And let me see if I can. I think it's.
Who's scanning? Which one?
That one.
Yeah.
Okay, it's control plus plus plus. Okay, you gotta hold down shift. That should be a lot more people, right? That better? Alright, let me do an Nmap. And I'm just gonna do 10.0.0.1. Let's see what comes back. Okay, that particular box has port 23 open TCP, 53 opens TCP, 80 TCP, and 172.20 is filtered. Let's try something else. Let's say we want to scan for UDP instead. That would be SU. Ah, shit, what am I doing? It helps you actually type the S. UDP is a lot slower. Remember, it doesn't have to respond back. And you might try more retries. It takes a little longer to actually figure it out because you don't necessarily know. Notice the only thing open, it's hard to know for sure if a port's open or closed or not. There you see I got 53 was open. By the way, that, of course, is my router on there. And that's why I get back from it. Now let's try the SYN scan. The SYN scan, just gonna give a same thing as actually, you know what I just realized? The first thing I did was not a TCP scan. A few things about defaults in Nmap. If you do a slash, a dash S, uppercase S, that's definitely a SYN scan. But by default, if you're running as root, it's going to do a SYN scan anyway. If you're not running as root, you can still use Nmap, but you'll be forced to use TCP scans. An explicit way to say TCP can't stand TCP scans and do explicit freeway handshake is a dash ST. And that does the explicit freeway handshake. What else would I want to cover here? But a few other things about defaults. Besides that thing I just said about root, by default it's going to be using SYN scans, whether or not you specify them. Also, the default ports that you're going to be scanning are, I believe now it's the top 1,000 ports based on what Fiorda did a study a while back of what the most top 1,000 ports are on the internet. It used to be, back in the day, it was like the top 1,023 and a few other special ports that are commonly open. But if you're doing that, essentially, if you don't specify what ports, it's like the top 1,000 ports as he's got in his survey. But you can specify more ports. But that's a simple syn scan, and both of those will give you a syn scan if you're running as root. Wildcard, now I was just addressing one IP address, but that's kind of lazy, that's kind of boring. We want to address more than that. So it's different ways of specifying ranges. And here's a few of them. You can use wildcards, so star, star. It's a quick way of doing it. You can also use ranges as saying 0 for 255, 0 for 255, and that does its range. There's also the CIDR notation, which you can use right here, which is 192.168, anything, anything that's going to scan. But all these are equivalent. These are the same thing, just different ways of writing it. Also, when you're doing targeting, you can use exclude. Like, let's say you want to do this entire range, but there's certain ones that are sensitive. Like, some devices fall over if you look at them wrong. I used to be back in the day, if you scan a network printer, it would actually print out reams and reams of paper, because it would, every single probe you sent it, it said, oh, port 9100, TCP, you're sending something to me. I just want to print it. Okay, let's send it out. So there's one, I referred to IUS before as a paper mill. That one particular day, I really made it a paper mill by scanning the network. All the printers on campus just started spewing out papers and using reams and reams. It was a beautiful thing. Yes, I was doing that with permission. Actually, I really was. We just didn't know it. I mentioned that Fyodor, and he put that in a special list of ports that, by default, they don't probe. Even if you say probe versions, I think there's a way of overriding that, but by default, he no longer probes 9100 because, yeah, it causes the spew paper all over the place. Also, you can use an input file, an exclude file, so you can say this range, but not this particular subsection of that range. And you can also specify ports by not only just doing dash P space and particular ports comma separated, you can also do dash P dash, which scans all ports but zero. Or if you want to explicitly state it, you can say dash P zero through 65,535. By the way, you notice that IP address, the host name I put up there, egads.metasploit.com. If anybody wants to test their egress firewalls for TCP, they have every TCP port open on that box, I believe. I believe that's what they set it up for. But yeah, it's a great talk practicing and saying, hey, will it let me talk out on this particular port? egads.metasploit.com. I'm not sure who set that up for you, but thank you, HD. We have to give you a hug at DebbieCon, or whoever set that up for y'all. HD Moore is one of the guys over at Mac 7. And the guy founded Metasploit. And that brings me to targets. If you want to try some targets in this class, here's some good ones. These are ones that people generally have permission to scan. For instance, hatme.imgeek.com, you can DDoS that. You can do whatever you want to that particular one. I don't care. I'm just experimenting with that. That's kind of a honeypot of sorts. Yeah, that's the ticket. So feel free to DDoS that one, scan it, whatever you want. By the way, I did a special thing for it. I tried to make it automatically tell who's coming at it and make it look like it's the same OS as they're running. It's a very special high-tech thing I've been working on, so I'm experimenting with it. Yo, give it a shot, let me know what you think. egads.metasploit.com, as I mentioned before, every single port open. That is really handy. I was using that recently to test egress filtering at the company that I did some work for. And of course, nmap.org has scanme.nmap.org. There's also things about discovery, but you know what? I never did actually give a demo of addressing entire networks, so let's do that real quick.
Adrian, your slide's going to be up on your
side. Oh, yes. All my slides will be up. Yeah, though I may fix them a little, because I just know a few things that I need to fix. But let me do an nmap star. I can go through all the other ways of doing it, but remember, I can use that star. I can do a 1 on the end and put a slash 24. I could do, 10, 0, 0, 1 through 254, whatever. You know, different ways I could address that. But right now, I'm just hitting everything on that particular network, and I should get a whole bunch of results back here shortly. But in the meantime, I'm going to switch over to this slide and we'll discuss the... Oh, actually, should we take a break? Or what do you think?
Yeah.
All right, let's go ahead and take a break and we'll be back in how many minutes?
10 minutes.
Let's give it 10 minutes, so let's be back at 10:30.
Cool.
Can we go back to the previous slide that had those...
Will do. Hold on a second, I'm just going to stop this for a second.